Our opening hymn is found page 292. What wondrous love is this?
Thank you. Let us now pray together our offertory prayer. Generous God, as we remember Jesus' temptation in the wilderness, we acknowledge the temptation that pursues so many of us to measure our worth, our power, and our security by what we have. As we offer these gifts to you this morning, we pray that you might deliver us from the temptation of building our lives around what belongs to us. Continually lead us to the conviction that what matters is that we belong to you. Amen.
Thank you.
thanks for the opportunity to serve you and to offer these gifts to you. And may they be used to bring about love and unity throughout the land. Amen.
Just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, this way, death spread to all people because all sinned. In fact, sin was in the world before the law, but sin is not charged to a person's account when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those who did not sin in the likeness of Adam's transgression. He is a type of the coming one. But the gift is not like the trespass. For if by the one man's trespass the many died, how much more have the grace of God and the gift which comes through the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflowed to the many? And the gift is not like the one man's sin, because from one sin came the judgment, resulting in condemnation. But from many trespasses came the gift, resulting in justification. If by the one man's trespass death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive the overflow of grace and the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ? So then, as through one trespass there is condemnation for everyone, so also through one righteous act there is justification leading to life for everyone. For just as through the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so also through the one man's obedience, the many will be made righteous. Word of God. For the people of God.
Thank you.
Thanks be to God.
Today's gospel reading comes from the gospel according to St. Matthew. I'll be reading from chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. This is Jesus, the story of Jesus being tempted in the desert. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And he fasted 40 days and 40 nights. And afterward he was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, "If you're the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on a pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you're the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will give his angels charge of you. On their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them. And he said to him, "All these I will give to you if you will fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Begone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks.
I don't know how many of you know who Lorenzo Sellers is. He's started a very profitable real estate firm, written many motivational books, and is a motivational speaker. He's based in Virginia Beach. And I'd like to read a little from one of his books this morning to begin the sermon. He writes, "In mid-2009, I left my position as CEO of a company that I founded. I didn't know it at the time, but this was the beginning of an almost four-year process that I can only describe as losing my identity. During this time, I would go through heartbreak and homelessness, question every aspect of my life. goes on to say, I spent 11 months living in my car and incurred massive debt. And after a challenging breakup, I didn't go on a single date for at least 18 months. I went through immense psychological stress and periods of time where I could see no light at the end of the tunnel. All the things that had been important to me dissolved. And he continues, as I began to let go of all of these things, I came to a very challenging psychological place. I had no idea who I was. With every core identity in question, I had a very hard time even socializing with other people. If I had no identity and couldn't connect with others, identity is how we see ourselves. It is the answer to the question, who am I? I don't know if you've ever seriously asked yourself that question. If you have, you may have found that the answer is not as obvious as you thought. Lorenzo Lemus Sellers continues his story. In experiencing my loss of identity, I could see that many of my actions were motivated by a desire for external recognition. I was either trying to impress others or worried about how they would judge me. However, any situation where my self-expression is contingent upon the validation of others is bound to limit me from being myself. And if I'm not being myself, how can I possibly be happy? True identity is being true to oneself. This morning's gospel lesson takes place immediately after Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River by John the Baptist. And we're told that when Jesus was baptized, he immediately came up out of the water. Heaven was open to him. And he saw the Spirit of God coming down like a dove and resting on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my Son, whom I dearly love. I find happiness in him. This is the core of Jesus' identity. Jesus is the Son of God. And baptism marks a new beginning. In Jesus' case, it was the beginning of Jesus' earthly ministry. So what does it mean to be God's Son, whom God loves, and in whom God finds happiness? What did it mean for Jesus? What does it mean for us? Jesus' temptation in the wilderness and how Jesus responded to these temptations gives us some very important clues as to who God is. When God takes on flesh and when God becomes a human, for those of us who profess to follow Jesus Christ, the Son of God and Savior, our identity is contingent upon Jesus' identity. Who are we? What does it mean that we're Christian? After all, the word Christian means little Christ. And how will we live out that identity? And these are the questions that we ask when we're faced with difficult choices in our lives. There can be no doubt that our identity is challenged the most when life gets hard. So what do we do when life gets hard? What do we do when everything is stripped away? You know, we're told in the scripture that Jesus was famished when he was tempted by the devil. The text literally says, after Jesus fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, he was starving. You know, we may find ourselves faced with temptations when we're stressed, when we're tired, when we're anxious or sick. And it was in the wilderness that the Israelites struggled to identify themselves as people of God. And when the going got tough, they created a golden calf to worship in the place of God. You know, we're tested when we face financial problems, when we have disagreements, or when we're threatened. These are the kind of situations that are the hardest for us to be the people that God has called us to be. Notice that the first two of Jesus' temptations challenge the issue of his identity directly. The tempter came to him and said, "Since you're God's son, command those stones to become bread." You know, that's got to be a huge temptation for someone who's not eaten for 40 days and 40 nights. So just how human is the Son of God willing to be? Will he indeed experience all the kinds of suffering that we experience, or will he use his power for his own personal need? You know, Jesus later miraculously fed others. He fed many people. But in the wilderness, he didn't even choose to feed himself in that same way. He decided not to escape human pain and human suffering. It's written, people won't live by only bread, but by every word spoken by God. Jesus identified himself with each one of us. He does what he asked of us. Rather than using his power for his own purpose, Jesus humbles himself and trusts in God the Father to satisfy his need. Here we see that the Son of God is the one who puts the needs of others above his own. He's come to serve, not to serve himself. And as Christians, we're called to that same identity. Our lives are not to be about me and mine. Instead, they should be about, what can I do to help my neighbor? What can I do to better serve God? And when we ask ourselves these kinds of questions, and when the going gets rough, we will find that God provides the answer. But we don't live by bread alone, but by every word spoken by God. In verse 5, we're told, after the devil brought him into the holy city and stood him at the highest point of the temple, he said to him, "Since you're God's son, throw yourself down. What is written, I will command my angels concerning you, and they will take you up in their hands so that you won't hit your foot on a single stone." This test focuses on Jesus' vulnerability and need for safety. The devil is inviting Jesus to make himself immune from injury and death. And the devil even quotes scripture in order to try to prove that Jesus agrees with him. But Jesus isn't deceived. Jesus will not misuse his power in order to make himself safe and secure. And while Jesus is hanging on the cross, we hear a near verbatim repetition of the devil's words by those who pass by and make fun of him. The scripture says, "He saved others. Why can't he save himself? He's the king of Israel, so let him come down from the cross now. Then we'll believe in him. He trusts in God, so let God deliver him now if he wants to. He said, I'm the Son of God." And by mocking Jesus and tempting Jesus, they're putting God to the test. Just like the devil did in the wilderness. But Jesus renounces all of these temptations. And in doing so, he's making his identity clear. He fulfills the scriptures as God's true son by humbly obeying God's will. Then the devil brought him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said, "I give you all of these things if you'll bow down and worship me." So in the third temptation, Jesus has to decide whom he will serve. He must decide how he will use his authority. Will he choose a life of power? Or will he choose the life of a servant? Later in Matthew chapter 16, we find a situation that's very similar. Jesus asks his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter said, "You're the Christ, the Son of the living God." But when Jesus tells the disciples what this means, that he will have to go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders, the chief priests, legal experts, that he'll have to be killed, then raised on the third day, Peter argues with Jesus about what it means to be the Son of God. He says Jesus is wrong about his identity. He tells Jesus that as the Son of God, he should not suffer, not go through the crucifixion and death. So what does Jesus say to him? He turned to Peter and he said, "Get behind me, Satan. You're a stone that can make me stumble, for you're not thinking God's thoughts, but human thoughts." Throughout his entire ministry, all the way to his death on the cross, Jesus defines what it means to be God's Son. And as followers of Jesus, we must define what it means to be a child of God. Who are we going to be? Most of us can't imagine the devil tempting us with bread after going 40 days without eating. We don't know the fear of being held over the ledge of the tallest building. And we certainly don't know the temptation of being offered all the power in the world. But we do understand pride, vanity, selfishness. Temptations come to us in the moments when we feel insecure about not having enough. Temptation comes to us in judgment we make about strangers who
we do not know and do not understand. Temptation rules us, making us able to look away from those in need and live without care in the world about poverty, disease, and hunger. And temptation rages in the moments when we allow the devil to define our lives, or when our addiction to wealth, power, and vanity, or need to control, overwhelms us. Temptation wins when we get so caught up in the trappings of life that we lose sight of life itself. And through his temptations, Jesus showed us that we choose who or whose we will be. Like Jesus, we will be hungry. We will have times when we are tempted to doubt God's faithfulness. And we will be tempted to reach for power rather than to live the life of a servant. To live as children of God, we must serve God, even when our circumstances are difficult and hard. This is when we really choose just what it means to be a child of God. The devil said to Jesus, "If you're the Son of God, do this or do that. If you're a child of God, who will we be? What will we do?" Let us pray. Holy God, help us to remain faithful to you in everything that we do. Lord, we pray that we will do all we can to bring you glory. If there's anything we've done because of our selfish interest, we ask that you forgive us. May we be faithful in our homes, our workplaces, our businesses, by doing what we've been taught and by living our lives according to your scriptures. In Jesus' holy name, we pray. And now let us pray together the model prayer that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now I'd ask you to stand with me and affirm your faith by reciting together the Apostles' Creed. It's found on page 881 in your hymnal. Together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life dedication is a love that will not let me go. Number 480 in your hymnal. Christ be with you now and forevermore. Amen.